Okay, so let's get right to it. Please welcome our candidates, Guy Caron, Charlie Angus, Jagmeet Singh, and Niki Ashton, who is joining us via satellite from Ottawa. You can clap. The debate will include a number of different formats. There will be 9 questions in 60 seconds, individual responses from each candidate, including 1 question in French, 4 3-minute open debates, and 2 15-second lightning round questions. There will also be 2 question period sections where each candidate will get an opportunity to ask another candidate of their choice a question. There will be 60-second opening statements and 90-second closing statements. Finally, each candidate has been given 30-second cue cards, which can be used once during the debate to give them an additional 30 seconds to speak at any point other than the opening and closing statements. This additional 30 seconds will come whenever the current response or debate concludes, and each candidate can only use the cue card once.
Now, let's begin. Good luck, bonne chance to all the candidates. We'll start with an opening statement, 60 seconds from each candidate. Mr. Caron, you're first.
Thank you very much. And I would also like to begin by acknowledging that we are currently on the unceded traditional territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations. Throughout my campaign, I've presented big transformative ideas that will reshape Canada into the fair, green, and prosperous country that we all want. But pour bâtir notre avenir commun, nous devons jeter un regard honnête sur notre passé. A fair reckoning of our country's history must include the reality of colonization and neo-colonialism's impact on the indigenous people of this land. This morning, I offered a comprehensive plan focusing on righting these wrongs, a plan which includes a National Council for Reconciliation accountable to the Parliament of Canada, the immediate signing of UNDRIP, and a solemn pledge to provide clean water to all indigenous communities. As we look forward, let us recommit ourselves to building a true nation-to-nation relationship founded on reconciliation, respect, consultation, and
Mr. Singh.
Thank you very much. Everybody, it's great to be here in Vancouver. I love spending time in BC. This leadership race has been our chance to grow our party. Together, we increased NDP membership to 124,000 members. My team recruited 47,000 new members to join our movement. They'll help us win in 2019. We owe it to Canadians to form government, to realize the social, economic, and environmental justice our country needs. Les infrastructures publiques doivent rester publiques. Nous devons placer les gens devant les profits. I believe in universal, publicly delivered social programs, but we must expand them with universal childcare, pharmacare, dental care, and free tuition. The only way to do that is to get us ready for 2019. That's what I'm doing, and that's what I will continue to do as your leader. Thank you.
Mr. Angus?
It's great to be here in NDP country, British Columbia. And what I've learned over the last 9 months and thousands of kilometers is that leadership is not about the leader. It's about giving people a reason to believe and getting active in politics, about speaking up for people who are being written off the political and economic map of our nation. I remember this woman in Windsor said to me, "Where's your party been since 2015? My pension is on the line. Will you have my back?" Well, this fall, I will be in Parliament taking on the Trudeau government's attack on defined pension benefits. I will be there speaking out against the lobbyists and the insiders for NAFTA, and I will call on Justin Trudeau to end the attack on the Human Rights Tribunal, because we have lost too many Indigenous children on our watch, and I don't want to lose any more. So, my friends, it's about choosing a leader with the experience and the determination to lead us this fall and towards government in 2019. Thank you very much.
Ms. Ashton?
I join you from unceded Algonquin territory. Progressive politics, smart politics, the politics of tomorrow, today. With growing inequality, catastrophic climate change, and the rise of hate. And I acknowledge Jagmeet for taking a stand against hate this past week. For far too long, we have been told progressive politics and popular support do not go hand in hand. My message today is that progressive politics is key to building a movement with broad support. Young people, millennials, the largest voting group in 2019, are overwhelmingly progressive. Women, indigenous, racialized voters, working people are key. They all want bold, progressive politics, a politics to believe in. Our campaign is connecting with social movements, inspiring longtime activists and people who are involved in politics for the first time. La politique progressiste, c'est la politique de l'avenir. It is time for social, environmental, and economic justice for all.
Thank you, candidates. Now let's get right to the first question. It is asked to all of the candidates, and you'll each have a chance to respond for 60 seconds. Inequality is one of the greatest challenges facing Canada today, as millions of Canadians struggle to pay the bills every month and no longer imagine their children will have more opportunities than they did. As Prime Minister, how would you tackle entrenched income inequality in Canada? We'll start with Mr. Singh.
Thank you very much. This was the first thing I launched with when I spoke about what it was important to me in this campaign, my four pillars. Inequality was the first pillar. And the first policy piece that I launched in this campaign was my income security agenda. And that outlines income security agendas for those who are most vulnerable in our society: seniors, Canadians living with disabilities, and the working poor. So I put forward a basic income guarantee for seniors, a basic income guarantee for Canadians living with disabilities, as well as an income supplement, a guarantee to ensure that those who are working but still live in poverty are lifted out of poverty. This is a crucial issue for our country. We know the reality that income inequality is growing. The status quo is not working. We have subsequent governments that have allowed this inequality to exist. We must take back this ground and fight for a more just future for Canada. We can do this. We can implement policies that actually take down and tear down inequality. I'm committed to doing that. The first policy piece I launched was on income inequality. We have a plan. With your support, we can implement it.
Ms. Ashton.
Well, there's no question that inequality is one of the biggest issues of our time. And our campaign has been strongly committed from the beginning on taking it on. I would begin by saying that inequality has many faces in our country: Indigenous peoples, racialized communities, immigrant, disabled, queer, trans, women, seniors. And for the first time in our history, the experience of the millennial generation, young people, intergenerational inequality, the likes we have never seen. And that's something that concerns me deeply as an older millennial. Not only do we need bold, progressive policies to take these on, including tax reform, making the rich and corporations pay their fair share, things like free tuition, we need environmental justice and standing up to big oil to be able to restore kind of equity and dignity to people across this country. But we also need to build a movement for fundamental change, a movement that looks beyond a couple of years, a movement that looks at challenging the status quo.
Mr. Caron?
It makes no sense that in a country as wealthy as Canada that we would have 6 million people living in poverty. My kids, Dominic and Edie, are 8 and 5. It makes no sense that their generation will be worse off than the generation before them, that your kids and grandkids will be worse off than you were. And we need to change that. Those are the results of the policies implemented by Liberals and Conservatives in the last 30 years. They promised us that by privatizing, by deregulating, by signing those trade agreements that leave many workers behind, that basically we will be better off as a society. Now we're told that we have to accept precarious work, we have to accept basically living paycheck to paycheck. It makes no sense. This is why I started this campaign, by promising to implement a basic income to eliminate poverty, to ensure that we can have everyone in this country above the low-income cutoff, and ensuring also that we can face the challenges of the transition towards renewable without leaving workers behind.
Mr. Angus.
It is absolutely unconscionable that in the city of Vancouver today, the number of seniors who are being evicted from the homes and the communities that they built because they can't afford to live there any longer, it has to be challenged. And I will be in Parliament this fall to ask Justin Trudeau, what is he going to do with the $4 billion surplus that's being handed to the Liberal government from the CMHC? Are they going to put that into more rubber ducks and tanks, or are they going to commit to a national affordable housing program so that people across Canada can live in dignity? I'll be challenging Bill Morneau, who's the privatized pension king of this country. They are like our prime ministers, like a young Ronald Reagan. They believe that if they look after people at the top of the economic food chain, everyone else will do okay. Well, we're not doing okay. We will go after those corporate stock loopholes, and we will start to build cooperatives and community-based economics. We have to get control of our economy and build it from the ground up to restore some fairness and some choice for Canadian citizens.
Thank you very much. It's now time for another 60-second response question. The question: a report released this year estimated that moving to a net zero emissions economy by 2050 could create nearly 4 million new jobs in Canada. What, in your view, is the best way to ensure that Canada takes advantage of our green jobs potential while reducing emissions? The first response will go to Mr. Caron.
Thank you very much. In the plan that I presented, which is called Climate Justice, we're talking about the need to invest, and we're talking about investments. This is not spending we're talking about. We're talking about something that will move Canada forward. We're lagging behind countries, especially in Europe, but also behind China in terms of investing in those technologies, investing in research, development, and innovation. So over and above what's being invested right now, I'm proposing to invest $90 billion in the next 10 years to speed up the investments that we'll need to do in research and development and partnering with the private sector to move towards that transition towards renewable, so investing in green industries and green technology. But we also need to make those investments to speed up electrification of transport, which is what we're not talking about when we're talking about fighting climate change. We need to make those investments in rail, in higher speed rail, to ensure that we can find a substitute for the all-polluting plane travel.
Mr. Singh.
Thank you very much. This is going to be one of the biggest obstacles and challenges of our generation. And to do this, we have to be very serious about the steps we need to take. I've proposed a green climate change plan, a climate change action, which talks about some of the steps we can take. So first off, we have an incredible abundance of green renewable energy in our country, but it's not connected. So one of the ideas I'm proposing is building a national publicly owned supergrid, which connects the renewable energy that we know exists in abundance in Manitoba and Quebec to other provinces, to create a grid across the country to electrify an entire country. This could allow for opportunities to feed in with solar and wind power. This would create jobs across the country. This is an innovative strategy. We also need to make sure that economic justice is not left behind. We cannot have environmental justice without economic justice. And that means we need to make sure there's transitions for workers to move into renewable, long-lasting, sustainable employment.
Mr. Angus.
The number one location in the world right now for creating a solar economy is South Central Alberta. If you take the best locations in Germany, they don't meet the worst locations in Alberta. So I was in Alberta meeting with the energy workers, the IBEW, who are training their workers. They see the future of a diversified energy economy and they say, where's the federal government? That's the fundamental question. We have to start talking about the opportunities, the incredible opportunities in Gaspésie for wind, the ability to make a solar economy. I would disagree with my colleague, Mr. Singh, about a big national grid mega project. I think what we need to do is we have to start working with investing with cities, the federal government working with cities that are the front line of climate change, because the more we diversify and localize energy, the less of a cost it will be, and the more sustainable our community. So I have proposed that we get a national project, Crown Corporation, that can do the partnerships with cities, with Indigenous communities, and with provinces to have public infrastructure sustainable.
Ms. Ashton.
Well, first I want to begin by talking about sharing, I guess, my thoughts with so many in British Columbia that have gone through a summer full of forest fires. We know many people across our continent and around the world are struggling with the impacts of climate change right now. And it is about the fate of our planet. And what we need is political will to act. I'm proud that our campaign has put forward a bold platform for environmental justice. In fact, we were the first campaign to put forward an idea of creating a Crown Corporation, Green Canada, to direct investment, federal investment, when it comes to building towards a green transition and a carbon-free economy. I also think it's very important that we make investments in green housing up to the tune of about $10 billion as we've put forward, recognizing that we can tackle climate change by addressing the needs of our communities across this country. And finally, let's build that movement as New Democrats, as progressives, to take on climate change today as it is so urgent.
Thank you very much, everyone. We will now move to our first open debate question. Candidates will have 3 minutes to debate the following question. As Canada enters the third round of renegotiations for NAFTA, many Canadians are concerned about the consequences of free trade deals for their jobs and communities. What principles do you believe the NDP should defend in these trade talks?
I think all New Democrats agree that the focus has been for too long on free trade, and the focus should be on fair trade. What is equitable trade? What is trade that actually puts workers first, that ensures that we have protections for the environment, protections for workers in other jurisdictions? What is the framework that we can put forward that ensures that instead of allowing benefits to flow to a small group of powerful corporations, the benefits of agreements actually flow to working people, to everyone in our country? For too long, the focus has been on those who already have, instead of focusing on the people. That should be the shift.
I've been in a deputy critic for international trade with my good friend Don Davies from Vancouver, and Don actually developed three lenses by which we have to look at all trade agreements. So I agree that we need to move forward towards fair trade, but how to do so? So we need to ensure that those trade deals are reciprocal so that we have reciprocity, the same access as those countries have here in Canada. And we have to ensure that we are winners in those deals, that our economy won't be worse off. But more important, we need to ensure that the country we're dealing with have strong human rights, labor rights, environmental rights, and or that trade agreement will actually contribute to raising those rights in those countries. And it's important for humanitarian reasons, but it's also important because when we're allowing lower standards in those countries, then we're allowing those countries to compete unfairly with our own workers.
Well, let's go to Niki. Sorry.
Go ahead.
Please. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, first I'd say that what we need is political backbone, and that's something that we haven't seen from Justin Trudeau. We're certainly not seeing it from the advisory committee that includes prominent conservatives and, of course, the advice of Brian Mulroney. The kinds of values we need to stand up for are workers' rights, our communities, our sovereignty. We need to get rid of Chapter 11 that allows corporations to sue Canadian governments. We also need to stand up for much bolder environmental rights, recognizing the threat of climate change. But what I would say finally is the recognition that trade deals, including NAFTA, have sold us out. We need to oppose the kind of trade deals that are before us, like CETA, the current version of the TPP, but recognize that for too long, trade deals have sold out manufacturing communities, communities that have produced so much of the wealth of this country, and we need to be able to stand up to the rich and powerful.
Thank you very much, Niki. We're going to go to Angus, please.
People of good jobs.
Mr. Angus?
Well, I'll keep it really simple. What you need is a leader in the House this fall, because it's going to be a feeding frenzy for lobbyists for NAFTA who are going to be working the back rooms. We're going to have to speak up. Because what's trade done for us when they've shipped out the processing fish jobs off Vancouver Island and we're exporting raw logs and we're losing longshoremen jobs here in Vancouver and they're going to contract out the building of ships? You need a leader in the House this fall who's going to take on Justin Trudeau, because I don't trust him any more than I trust Brian Mulroney. We have to stand up for our communities.
Thank you, everyone. We'll now move to another 60-second response question. Under the Conservatives, Canada was frequently criticized for treating foreign affairs as an extension of domestic politics and abandoning Canada's traditional role. Since the Liberals have come to power, the rhetoric has changed, but many policies have not. As leader, what would be your priorities in the foreign affairs file? Ms. Ashton, you're up first.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm proud that from the beginning of this campaign, we've talked about the need for the NDP and Canada to be a voice for peace in the world. And I'm proud that right from the get-go, we've been very clear on the need to defend human rights and international law. I'm proud of the position that we've taken in terms of supporting peace and justice in Palestine, a position that we as New Democrats must be strong on. And there's so much more to fight for, including against bad arms trade deals, including with Saudi Arabia, recognizing that instead of ramping up our military budget, we should be looking at, yes, supporting development around the world and investing in people here at home. I recognize that there are many challenges around the world that Canada could be a positive voice. And I think right now of the kind of targeting of Rohingya Muslims in Myanmar, and recognize that Canada, whether it's there or around the world, ought to be that voice for peace and justice for all.
Mr. Singh.
Thank you very much. We know that Canada has a long history of being a nation that's inspired the world with respect to peacekeeping and diplomacy. And for too long, we've lost that position at the international stage. So our goal should be diplomacy, peacekeeping, international development. But specifically, when it comes to peacekeeping and diplomacy, we need to be champions once again of nuclear disarmament, of military disarmament, in terms of using that as it's no longer an option, as a tool to resolve our difficulties, our problems. We need to make sure that when it comes to international development, we focus on human rights development and protecting the rights of people across the world. We know right now there's some serious crisis going on, particularly with the Rohingya community, the Muslims in Myanmar. It's a tragedy. It's horrible. It's horrendous. We need to be a voice that speaks out against those injustices. This is our time. This is our space. We need to take it back. We are a nation that believes in peacekeeping and diplomacy and justice, and we will do that on the international stage.
Mr. Angus?
I was always really proud growing up watching how the New Democrats worked with Mike Pearson. And we helped establish a vision of Canada that inspired the world. And we need to pick up our game, my friends. In a world of increasing intolerance, a world of increasing violence, this fall, one of the very first questions I'll be asking the Prime Minister is why Canada is not taking a strong position on the Rohingyas. This is the moral leadership we need to be showing. Where is Canada with the crisis with North Korea? The Prime Minister cannot act like Donald Trump's favorite pet poodle. We have to have an independent policy that's based on a moral vision, but also a willingness that we're going to put the investments into diplomacy, that we're going to put the investments into international maternal health, and to start showing that Canada really can be a player. And I think that we have an opportunity. I have a lot of hope in our present Prime Minister. I just don't think he quite gets it sometime. And I would be there to help him drag him into the 21st century.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Caron.
You are right about talking. Our Liberals talk a good game, but they are not really acting. When Donald Trump asked of Canada to increase its military spending, Justin Trudeau was happy to oblige. And we're moving towards that 2% of GDP objective that NATO is setting. How come it's desirable to move to 2% of military spending of our GDP when it's just unfeasible to actually move to 0.7% of our GDP on international aid? It makes no sense. Canada used to be known around the world as the honest broker, as the country that could be trusted to act as a mediator, as a country that could be trusted in peacekeeping missions. And that's another element where the Liberals promised to rise our profile in peacekeeping. I haven't seen any of this so far. So what we need to do is to establish Canada's place in the world as the honest broker, as a country that can be relied upon, as the middle power that can do so much and did so much in the past.
Thank you very much. For the next question, candidates will once again have 60 seconds to respond. And the question is, recent data shows Canadian women still earn on average only 87 cents for every dollar earned by men. Despite this, the Liberal government has so far refused to enact proactive pay equity legislation to put the onus on employers to close the wage gap. If you were elected leader, how would you pressure the government to act for pay equity? Ms. Ashton, once again, we're going to give you the first response.
Well, first of all, I want to acknowledge the incredible work of our caucus, particularly our colleague Sherry Benson, for her work in fighting for pay equity for women. I mean, who would have thought a self-professed feminist Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau, wouldn't actually act on his priorities? A real Liberal. I would say that when it comes to fighting for equality, there's no question that, yes, the NDP has a strong track record, but we need to make sure that equality and justice for women is really top of the line in terms of the work we're doing. Racialized women, Indigenous women face even greater pay inequity. Women living with disabilities, queer women. These are the kinds of realities we need to be tackling. As leader, it would be a priority for me to fight for pay equity and also to make sure that we are connecting with women across this country in building a government that truly believes in equality for women.
Mr. Angus.
We have to look at the issue of pay equity in terms of the refusal of the federal government to get serious about actually making change that helps people. I am so proud of the work of the women leaders in our movement who fought on this issue year after year. And it's even more important as we see the contracting out the so-called gig economy, the fact that the federal government is the number one exploiter in Canada of temp work. And these aren't temp occasionals. These are people working permanent jobs for the federal government, some at $12 an hour. They can't pay their bills. And as soon as they're up for being able to get benefits, they get laid off and they start on that hamster wheel of inequality again. And who, my friends, are suffering the most in this? It's women. They are women, and especially women with young children, who are affected time and time again. We will be in the House this fall pushing this Prime Minister to start living up to the commitments that we have to make our society a fairer place.
Mr. Caron?
Yeah, on my side, I'd like to acknowledge also the work that Nicole Turmel, our former colleague, has done, especially when she was at the head of PSAC. And when she was there, she was facing Liberals who challenged all the efforts of PSAC and all the rulings that were made in favor of pay equity in public service. This is what Liberals are about. They will tell you and talk a good game and tell you that they are your friends and they want to work with you. But in the end, they are acting the same way Conservatives are. And it makes no sense. The last example of this is the delay that they are bringing forth in establishing pay equity. What we need to do is to follow the example of Iceland. I don't know if you know, but Iceland, at the beginning of our leadership race, decided to legislate to ensure that equal work would mean equal pay, that we will ensure that this is not only an empty rhetoric or an empty promise, that it will be legislated. We can do it at the federal level, and we can provide the example for the provinces to follow suit after us.
Mr. Singh?
Thank you. There's no question about it. We absolutely need to implement proactive pay equity legislation immediately. It has to be done. But what we need to do is call out the hypocrisy of a government that claims to be a government and a leader that cares about issues of gender justice, that cares about feminism, and call out the hypocrisy. A government that's agreed to do a trade deal with one of the most oppressive regimes in the world is not a government that cares about feminism. A government that continues to deny equality and justice for women is not a government that cares about issues of feminism. And when it comes to other areas of inequality, we know, as Charlie said, women are disproportionately impacted. So one of the issues that I care very deeply about, an issue that's impacted my riding for years, is temporary job agencies. And these agencies are most often used at the federal level. They exploit people, and particularly marginalized people, racialized people, and women. So I put forward legislation at the provincial level calling for an end to this exploitation. And at the federal level, and part of my work's agenda is to say that there's no way that anyone that works through any form of agency should see their employment, their salary, their benefits in any way exploited.
Thank you very much. It's now time for another open debate, candidates. You'll have 3 minutes in total to discuss the following. In 2001, Portugal legalized all drugs in an effort to deal with an overdose crisis. And some have advocated that Canada take the same approach, particularly in light of the upcoming legalization of marijuana. What's your view on this proposal? And because it's difficult during the open debate for Niki to jump in via satellite, we'll let her kick it off.
Well, thank you for this important question. First of all, I do think that we should be looking at the Portuguese model when it comes to dealing with addictions and obviously working with people that are struggling. We also need to be moving straight ahead towards full support for harm reduction measures here in our own country. It's clear to me that Stephen Harper and his government pulled us so far to the right. We lost a lot of ground over these last few years, and I want to acknowledge Libby Davies and so many on the ground in Vancouver who fought for insight, who are fighting constantly across this country for harm reduction programs. We need federal investment so that cities, communities, First Nations can establish harm reduction programs across our country, and so that we don't stigmatize addiction, that instead we are working with people to build healthier and
safer communities. It's an open debate,
I worked in the criminal justice system for a number of years, and I can tell you that people that are charged with personal possession offenses are often those who are poor, who are often those who have mental health issues, and often those who are addicted. That does not sound to me like a criminal justice problem. That sounds to me like a social justice problem and a healthcare problem. I would call for the immediate decriminalization of all personal possession offenses when it comes to drugs, period. It's not acceptable in our country. It's something that doesn't actually help our country. And what it does is it criminalizes those that are already so worse off in society. It puts people who are already marginalized into a worse position. It doesn't help our society. And what we need to do immediately is to decriminalize and work towards harm reduction, supports, and rehabilitation.
What we need to be looking at, I worked with the homeless in Toronto in the 80s. And I got to say, I had such a deep gut hatred of addictions and what it did to people. But I've seen what fentanyl is doing, and we are being brought into completely uncharted territory. And they're not just dying in downtown Vancouver. They're dying in Surrey. They're dying in Kitsilano. I've been to funerals in my riding, and we need a new strategy. It's not just about having safe sites. We have to find a way to have access. I don't know if it's decriminalization or some kind of program to work with the addicts who are suffering, who can have safe access to drugs while putting the investments into other methods to get people off.
Charlie, the question is the portion of the model. You're not actually answering the question. The question is, do you support the continued prosecution of people just because they have mental health issues? Do you support the continued prosecution of people because they're poor? Do you support the continued prosecution of people who are addicted?
No.
Then let's call for a move to decriminalize
I will turn
all
it over to. I'll turn it over to Guy. We can talk later.
I think as an economist... As an economist, I can tell you that repression is the worst of policies. I mean, no one can tell me that repression worked. And it didn't work because addiction cannot be treated as a crime. It has to be treated as a disease. It has to be treated as an illness. This is why the idea of decriminalizing is a good idea to be studied and to ensure also in a parallel fashion that we can put resources, the needed resources, in harm reduction, because harm reduction is not only helping to treat that disease, but it's also helping...
Thank you very much. Just a reminder to the audience, I know it's difficult, but please refrain from applauding so we can just move forward and stick to the script. Now is the time for the first candidate-to-candidate question period. Each candidate will get to pose a question to another candidate of their choice. They will have 30 seconds to ask the question, and the chosen candidate will have 30 seconds to respond. The questioner will then have another 30 seconds for a follow-up, followed by final 30-second response from the candidate to be questioned. Candidates are reminded that their questions must seek clarification of a difference in policy or position and should not be asking for agreement or consensus. The first candidate to pose a question is Jagmeet Singh.
Thank you. My question is to Charlie. A lot of misinformation has been spread about my plan to lift seniors out of poverty. Let me be clear. I will enhance the old age security by $4 to $5 billion, not change the process whatsoever. I will get rid of the Harper era boutique tax credits and put that funding into enhancing OAS to lift 600,000 seniors out of poverty. Charlie, what will you do for these seniors?
Well, I want to thank my colleague for that question. I guess I still can't get over the fact that you would put a means test on old age security at $70,000. Because I know many seniors who have to sell their homes to pay for their home care, and it costs $60,000 to $70,000 a year. I don't think that going after them to pay to help the poor is progressive, and it's certainly not something that we've stood for before. So we will talk about a national seniors program for housing and for GIS to get all seniors.
30-second follow-up.
Clearly, you can't hear what I'm saying. I'm saying I'm not changing. I'm enhancing the program. Currently, 150,000 seniors who do not apply for guaranteed income supplement. My plan to enhance OAS would roll in the means-tested GIS the way it currently exists, roll it into the old age security so more seniors in poverty can automatically, without any application, receive a greater benefit. Would you maintain the means-tested guaranteed income supplement, or would you help these seniors? What would you do?
Well, I certainly don't believe in means tests for seniors, my friend. And this is what I said to you in Saskatoon, that I was quite shocked that you brought forward a means test and said it was a new Democratic Party idea. I mean, that was Brian Mulroney's idea. That was Jean Chrétien's idea. Because you said to me, my friend in Saskatoon, that at 70,000, that's where the means test comes in. Well, I know seniors who sold their houses to live in medically assisted homes, and they pay $60,000, $65,000, I wouldn't means test them, my friend. That's the difference between our
position. And Singh has put up his 30-second card.
First of all, you don't understand the position whatsoever. I'm saying that the OAS is a great program. I would enhance it. I would get rid of GIS, which is mean tested, and put that into OAS. I don't think you understand the issue here. I'm saying let's get rid of the Harper-era boutique credits and put those into OAS to enhance OAS. So I don't think you agree with enhancing OAS. I think you agree with seniors living in poverty. Because if you don't understand the plan, how can you criticize it?
Well, my friend, I certainly spent my life fighting.
Okay, we're going to the next question. Is there not a 30-second follow-up for the...
30-second follow-up to 30-second question, yeah.
No.
Okay.
I don't need...
Okay, we're gonna, unless you want to use your 30-second card, we can move on then to Mr. Angus. It's you. Your question, yes, to a candidate, please.
I would like to ask a question of Niki Ashton, because, Niki, I've been so inspired by your determination in this campaign on the issue of post-secondary and the crisis that we need to address. But I'm concerned we can't wait for 2019. What are the steps that you will take coming back into Parliament that we can start to push this government to take real coherent action to make it easier for people who are suffering under such heavy levels of student debt? What's your plan?
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for that question, Charlie. And you're absolutely right. People are facing a crisis. First of all, if I were to be leader, I would bring in a post-secondary act, something we as New Democrats have fought for years. Jack Layton obviously was a major champion of that. But you're right, we also need to be looking at student debt. So yes, free tuition and how do we get there, but also student debt. For example, taking out or removing the federal interest rate on student loans, which is critical, and looking at how we can support students that are on the margins.
30 seconds.
Well, thank you. I certainly really especially like the idea about interest on student debt, because we can move on that. But what I've been hearing talking in universities is the corporatization of universities. We got so many faculty who are working as basically temp workers. I'm concerned about transfers of funds to universities unless we actually have a commitment and a plan for doing research, for making sure that we are the people who've put their efforts into getting an education are able to have quality work. What's your plan for that, Ms.
Ashton?
And
the final 30 seconds goes to Ms. Ashton.
Mm-hmm. Well, I just want to go back to a key plank of our campaign as well, Charlie, that would get at challenging the corporatization of universities, and that would be by making tuition free, recognizing that the federal government needs to step up its investment in post-secondary education. It was the Liberals in the 90s that let us down, and it's been downhill all since that time. But we need to get with the times. You know, over 17 countries around the world offer free tuition. Canada should be one of them. We shouldn't be indebting students, families, when it comes to accessing most...
Mr. Caron?
Thank you. Jagmeet, when you launched your campaign, you put electoral reform as one of your top four priorities, but I haven't really heard you talk much about it. I'm furious that Trudeau can think he can get away with the bald-faced lie he actually did in 2015. I'm serious about electoral reform. That's why I said it will be the first bill tabled under me as the leader of an NDP government. This is the last debate. I can't find your plan on your website. How committed are you to make electoral reform a reality?
First of all, I got to give you credit. Your plan is a phenomenal plan. You put forward a bold plan on mixed member proportional representation with regional lists. It's a plan that I support. We have not yet put up our plan on our website and not released it yet, but it's a plan that I'm actually inspired by your plan, so I'm looking at that. Mm-hmm. I've spoken to, it's a great plan. I got to give him credit. It's a good plan.
And he's a smart guy.
He is great. Mm-hmm. and no, so it's true. And so I've also spoken with some other folks looking at how do we ensure that there's still the regionality, people can vote for their own members, but we have to move towards proportionality, no question.
Thank you very much. We know that Trudeau campaigned on electoral reform, and he got many of our people and our youth to vote for him. He had no plan. So this is why it's important to actually have a plan. We have to recognize that the cynical way that Trudeau scuttled the parliamentary process on this matter would have made Stephen Harper proud. So I'm really serious about electoral reform. That's why I offered a plan that would include also a possibility in terms of minority government and our support. So you support all of this, including our plan as a minority government?
Absolutely. I think we need to make electoral reform a foundational piece of our party, of our platform. It's going to fundamentally shape and change the face of democracy in Canada. We would no longer have the specter of a party getting only 40% of the vote and getting 100% of the power. We'd get rid of vote splitting, the fear of strategic voting. This would literally be a game changer. It's so fundamentally important, and it's got to be proportional representation. I support you all the way on this.
Thank you.
Okay, and we will now go to Ms. Ashton.
So to Jagmeet, I've talked a lot in this campaign about rebuilding our movement in every region of this country, and not just during the leadership. I've worked with New Democrats to build the party for many years, in Saskatchewan when we had no seats, in Alberta and BC before the breakthroughs, in Ontario and Quebec, the Maritimes and the far north. In this leadership campaign, you've signed up significant numbers of members in a handful of ridings, but haven't put forward a concrete regional or national action plan to build a progressive movement. Why?
So we support a national campaign, And that's why we opened up two offices. We're the only campaign that's opened up two offices, one in Toronto, one in Vancouver. We believe in building a national movement, and that's why we signed up 47,000 new members. In fact, in Quebec, where we need to do far more work, we've signed up a third of the members there. 1,500 new members signed up in Quebec were members we signed up. We absolutely believe we need to grow the party, and that's why I spent some time out in Nova Scotia just last week, in Lunenburg, in Halifax. We've got to be national and grow across the country.
30-second follow-up, Ms. Ashton.
So we have a lot of work to do throughout the country, as you've pointed out, where we have no seats, including places like Toronto and the Atlantic. And we can't ignore Quebec, where we must be able to communicate in French. I know what it's like to stick with the party when I didn't win. Will you do the same if you don't win, starting with running in Brampton, where you have signed up many members, or any other federal seat? Are you committed to being part of the federal NDP, regardless of the outcome of this leadership?
Well, the answer is yes, because I'm going to win. I'm absolutely running federally. No question about it.
Okay,
I will
audience,
be running.
Please.
I'm honored to
audience,
do so.
Please.
I think
reminder.
We have an amazing opportunity to grow our party across the country. And having a national leadership team that involves you, Niki, and all these candidates here, we're going to grow our party. We're going to do so many phenomenal things. Look at what we did in just a couple of months. We signed up so many members. All of us increased the membership to 124,000. Imagine what we could do together in 2 years. We're going to take over this country and build a progressive future. For more.
Hey, Niki is going to use her 30-second for response. Niki?
So, Jagmeet, you said the same thing in Montreal. I want to acknowledge that, you know, it's up to the members to decide who wins this race. But I think what we need to hear is your plan. Where are you going to run, and how will it look like once this leadership race is over? If I win, I'd like you to run. You are a key member of the team, without question. But I think what members, what New Democrats deserve to know is what your plan is in the next while to build the movement.
We're out of time now. Thank you very much. We'll now have another question for open debate. In your view, what is the issue that has not received enough attention in this leadership debate? Candidates, you now have 3 minutes in this open format to discuss.
I'm of the opinion that we haven't talked enough about healthcare. It's one thing to say that we have a need for pharmacare, we have a need for universal dental care, for mental health, home care, but it's another one to bring about a comprehensive view of how we'll bring those changes. We've seen in the last negotiations by the federal Liberals that they can't get a deal with the provinces. They can't actually move forward and negotiate fairly with the provinces. They have their view, and the provinces' opinion doesn't count. The provinces have to speak to each other, and we need to ensure that the federal government plays a leadership role, but we also need to develop and present to Canadians an integrated vision of what healthcare has to look in the future, integrating all those elements as a whole.
You're right.
We're going to bring Niki in just because it's so hard for her via satellite. Jump in.
Thank you. Well, I'd say one area that certainly hasn't gotten enough attention is foreign policy. I mean, we've had a few questions and a couple of debates, but I think as New Democrats, what's clear is that we're very passionate about being a voice for justice, not just here at home, but also abroad. I mentioned earlier how I'm proud that our campaign took a clear stand on peace and justice in Palestine. Unfortunately, I mean, that's an issue that we've been too quiet on for too long. We need to stand up much clearer, whether it's in terms of the increased militarization agenda of Justin Trudeau, whether it's the kind of appeasement of the Trump regime, whether it's the need to be a voice for peace in a world increasingly intolerant. I believe that New Democrats, we need to spend more time being a stronger voice.
We're
going to
take it
policy.
Back to the floor.
An issue that's gotten literally no, though, coverage whatsoever in these debates. We've talked a bit about foreign policy, and I think Niki's point's great. We've talked a bit about healthcare. Guy's made a good point. But we've not talked about immigration. Immigration has built our country. Immigration is foundational. We have an ongoing discourse around hatred, and we know that to build our nation even more in the future, immigration isn't just something that makes our country more rich and diverse. It's something that we need economically. We need it to grow our country. So immigration is an area we need to talk about. How do we increase numbers of immigration? How do we bring in talented folks from around the world? How do we deal with issues like the refugee and asylum-seeking crisis, where we have a safe third country agreement that needs to be suspended in order to deal with and address the oncoming folks that we are not being able to address in a meaningful way?
Well,
so these are some issues of key importance.
I think a fundamental question in this race is, what is the role of a social democratic party with our base? Because, my friends, when was the last time anybody from the party ever asked your opinion? They just asked you for money. We got to change that. If we're a social democratic movement,
We have to re-energize our base, and that's what I've learned from 9 months on the road, is we have incredible people at the grassroots. If we're not out organizing the unorganized, then what difference is it between us and the blah, blah, blah of the other parties? I think that is the fundamental question about re-democratizing, putting the democratic back into NDP.
Okay, just a quick reminder. We really need you to refrain from clapping because we are live and we really want to respect the candidates and have the opportunity to hear what they're saying. So we're now going to move on to, we're at the lightning. Mm-hmm. We're at the lightning round section of today's debate.
Uh-oh.
There's two lightning round questions and each candidate will only get 15 seconds to answer each one. The first question is, what is the fundamental difference between Liberals and the New Democrats? And Mr. Angus, you're up first. You have 15 seconds.
Well, I think many Liberal people share many of our values, and I think we have to always be reaching out to bring them over. The difference is following through, that we have to be a party that is willing to make our promises actually become reality, and that's where we differ.
Mr. Caron?
I remember having the same question in Montreal, in Ottawa, in the first debate, and I answered the same thing I will answer you now, which is, we mean what we say, and we say what we mean. Basically, when you are going to elect an NDP government, you'll get the results. Under Liberals, well, we have progressive promises.
Mr. Singh.
We have the courage to follow through with our principles. For us, we seek power for the purpose of implementing our values and our principles to build a more just and inclusive Canada. Liberals make promises in the pursuit simply of power. That's the key difference.
Ms. Ashton?
Well, I would say principles. And yes, no question, a number of folks that voted for Justin Trudeau feel strongly about the work we do as New Democrats and support our work. But what I think what people have seen over the last couple of years is that while Justin Trudeau talks a progressive talk, he's broken so many promises.
Okay.
And it's New Democrats.
Thank you very much. Lightning question number two is, what is your one quality that best suits you to be the Prime Minister? And Mr. Angus, you are first once again.
To be Prime Minister, you have to be able to bring people together. We have to have a vision, we have to have fire, we have to have political backbone, but it has to be about bringing people together. It is a fundamental principle of my whole career, building that movement.
Ms. Ashton?
I would say passion. For me, politics is about passion, it's about people, and if you don't have the fire in the belly, then there's no point in sticking around. For me, it's been important to be a voice for justice from where I come from and on various national issues, and I believe if we're going to go forward, we have to
Mr. Caron?
I would say it's the ability to build bridges. I've done that all my life in the student movement, in civil society, in the labor movement as well. The ability of ensuring that Quebec progressives would work with Canadian progressives. The ability to link up the issues that are of concern among all regions, but also among urban realities and rural realities.
And Mr. Singh.
I'm going to break the rules a little bit. It takes an act of love to see that we're all in this together, that we're all connected. And it takes an act of courage to demand bigger, better, to dream bigger, and to fight for a more just Canada. So I have love and courage.
Thank you. Merci. It's now time for our one French language question. You'll have 60 seconds each to answer. La question. Il y a plus d'un million de Canadiennes et de Canadiens vivant à l'extérieur du Québec. Dans la langue maternelle et le français. En tant que Premier ministre, que ferez-vous pour promouvoir et protéger le français dans la communauté francophone hors du Québec? Monsieur Angus.
C'est une question importante pour ma région de Timmins Bay James. Dans la région de la Nord-Ontario, il y a beaucoup, beaucoup, beaucoup de communautés et beaucoup de gens qui parlent en français. Et je suis très fier de travailler avec les leaders et les communautés dans ces régions-là, mais c'est aussi essentiel pour protéger les droits linguistiques partout au Canada. Par exemple, dans ma région, les besoins d'accès aux services santé francophones, c'est important d'avoir accès à l'éducation super pour les communautés, mais aussi c'est nécessaire pour défendre les nominations de le rôle de la commissaire des langues officielles pour limiter les nominations partisanes des libéraux parce que ce rôle de ce commissaire c'est important pour défendre les intérêts des communautés francophones partout au Canada.
Monsieur Caron.
Comme Québécois, c'est une réalité à laquelle je suis, que j'ai, connu, j'ai appris sur le tard, en fait, en déménageant à Ottawa pour étudier à l'université et en étant en contact avec des Franco-Ontariens, en apprenant leur réalité aussi. Et ça m'a permis, entre autres, de pouvoir être présent lors de l'Assemblée de fondation de la Fédération des communautés francophones et acadiennes et de pouvoir continuer mon implication auprès de diverses communautés francophones à l'extérieur du Québec. Je pense qu'il faut absolument reconnaître le manque de ressources qu'on a présentement et le manque de vision du gouvernement fédéral. On a besoin de pouvoir investir massivement. Et je sais qu'il y a des champions ici en Colombie-Britannique, entre autres Adrian Dix, qui a fait de la Colombie-Britannique vraiment une province qui était à l'avant-garde au niveau de l'apprentissage du français comme langue seconde. Et le fait d'apprendre le français comme langue seconde aide également à la communication et à faire comprendre l'importance et la place que prennent nos minorités francophones à l'extérieur du Québec. Je pense aussi qu'il faut s'assurer que les langues officielles ne soient pas politisées de la manière que cela a été sous les libéraux, alors qu'ils ont tenté de le faire avec la commissaire.
Merci. Monsieur Singh.
Pour moi, si on voit la réalité dans notre pays, qu'on a deux langues, ça donne une richesse au pays. Le fait qu'on a deux langues, ça donne une diversité au pays. Mais il faut aussi protéger ces langues. Et avec la langue française, on sait qu'il y a beaucoup de régions à travers le pays qui ont un héritage très fort, comme les provinces atlantiques, Manitoba, Saskatchewan. On a des provinces qui ont des francophones. Mais la réalité, c'est qu'elle est très difficile de continuer d'apprendre le français dans les autres provinces au lieu de Ontario et peut-être Nouveau-Brunswick. Pour moi, quand j'étais jeune, un homme, un enfant dans une ville anglophone, c'était très difficile pour moi d'apprendre le français. Je n'étais pas dans une école immersion, mais j'ai décidé d'apprendre le français. Mais on doit créer une situation, un système qui donne un avantage pour créer un système qui est plus facile d'apprendre.
Merci. Madame Ashton.
Je dirais que cet enjeu me touche. J'ai eu la bonne chance de pouvoir étudier le français dans une école d'immersion dans ma ville, Thompson, au nord du Manitoba. Mais c'était grâce à la lutte qu'ont fait plusieurs parents, la petite communauté de francophones chez nous, pour pouvoir avoir cette réalité. C'est clair que pour protéger la langue française hors du Québec, on a besoin du leadership du niveau fédéral. On a besoin des ressources. Il faut investir dans l'apprentissage de la langue. Il faut investir dans les services publics fédéraux, s'assurer qu'ils s'offrent dans les deux langues officielles. Il faut s'assurer qu'on protège le bilinguisme à tous les niveaux, inclusivement celui des juges de la Cour suprême, qu'ils soient bilingues. Et à la fin de la journée, il faut reconnaître que ce n'est pas la rhétorique qui va protéger le français, c'est l'investissement et de l'action. C'est quelque chose que je ferai comme chef.
Thank you very much, candidates. Here's another question for which you will get 60 seconds to reply. 2 weeks ago, the Liberal government announced that Indigenous Affairs would be split into two departments, one to work on new relationship with Indigenous peoples, and one to provide services to First Nation communities. The Prime Minister has called this a next step in getting rid of the Indian Act. What is your reaction to this announcement? Mr. Singh, you have 60 seconds.
Much like the Liberals' reactions, this is just a great PR message, but is it actually doing anything to advance the issues? What we know would advance the issues is we have a government that right now has denied Indigenous children equitable funding. We have a Canadian Human Rights Tribunal that's issued 4 compliance orders. To each of those orders, this very same Prime Minister has said, no, I don't agree that they deserve equal funding, and I'm going to appeal this decision. That's offensive. That's unacceptable. And that demonstrates a lack of care or consideration for true reconciliation. The starting point for reconciliation is to not contravene Human Rights Tribunal court orders or tribunal orders. The second step is to actually follow through on a true nation-to-nation relationship, which means treating with nations as you would any other nation. That's the same thing that we need to see happen here in Canada. It's not happening, but we'd make it happen under the NDP.
Mr. Angus?
We lost a 12-year-old girl in Wapakika this week. That's the fourth one. From a direct result of the government being found culpable in the deaths of children in Wapakika for refusing to put the funds in place. They were found guilty of that. And now we have the Prime Minister at federal court fighting the Human Rights Tribunal. I don't care how many ministers you put in Indian Affairs. I don't care how often you change the color of the paint, how many desks, how much you change the name. That is a system of 150 years of colonialization that has destroyed the hopes of people across this country. And I've seen in the last 15 years, nothing changes until we dismantle that institution. We have to have a full public audit because I'll tell you, nobody knows how much money goes in there and nobody knows how it comes out. And we have to make sure that the services are in the control of the communities so that they can build the communities for their future to protect their children and have a better future. That's what decolonization means.
Mr. Caron?
For someone like the Prime Minister who always likes to say that this, the relationship we have with our indigenous peoples is the most important relationship, it took them 2 years to realize that they were not moving forward. 2 years? I mean, we're looking at the great work Charlie, among other people, and Georgina and Romeo Saganash have done in the House, ensuring that liberals would be held into account, and there was still no movement. The way I see it, the splitting of this department into two departments would be an opportunity for the liberals to break their words twice as many times. I've given up hope with this government to actually do anything meaningful other than paying lip service to the challenges that our indigenous people are in this land are actually experiencing. We need true movement. I've presented today a blueprint towards action with indigenous peoples and First Nations in this country, and it will not happen unless we have an NDP government in this country.
Ms. Ashton.
Well, the question is, how many departments does it take to legislate poverty and underfunding? The reality is that the Liberals, despite their rhetoric and their commitment and, frankly, their symbolism, they haven't actually made a difference in terms of improving the lives of Indigenous people. And as has been pointed out, you know, the Human Rights Tribunal has directed them three times, and they've received pressure from the international community, let alone what's been said here at home. And they still refuse to treat Indigenous children the way any other child across this country is treated. What's necessary here is, yes, to decolonize our system, and that means allowing Indigenous people, supporting Indigenous people to take the lead. And I'm proud of the work that Romeo Saganash and Georgina Jolie-Bois have done and many, many activists across this country in pushing for the adoption and implementation of the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. This is the way forward. We as New Democrats are the only ones that can speak up and alongside work in solidarity with Indigenous.
Thank you. We're at time. We're moving on to another three-minute open debate. The question, over the course of this leadership race, membership in the party has tripled. What is your plan to build on the success and further increase the membership of the NDP?
Well, I do think that the problem that we have right now is a problem of outreach. Outreach is really the key to everything. And we have missed a great opportunity in the 4 years and a half we were the official opposition. A great opportunity to actually use this standing that we had to build those bridges, to create those links with various communities that are forming our large cities like Vancouver and Toronto and Montreal, but also with rural Canada as well. We are not doing outreaching the proper way, and I would claim that we are likely 10, 15 years behind Liberals and Conservatives in that regard. So we need to reconnect with Canadians. We need to reconnect with members first and foremost, and have our members helping us reconnect with Canadians, with kitchen assemblies, with ensuring that we can get across this great country of ours to demonstrate what our plan will be for the future.
We build grassroots organizers on the ground. We know that the only way to build out, to reach out, to develop our party is to actually have organizers on the ground. And that's why we were able to sign in 47,000 new members. We spoke to these new members. We engaged with them. We put forward a vision of what's going to be a better Canada, how we can make a more just and more progressive Canada. And we communicated with people in a way that touches their heart. We know that we need to communicate with people in a way that's emotional, that's evocative, that's inspirational, and that's what we're able to do. But we need to continue to do that. We also need to hire people in communities we want to reach out to. If we don't have people that are working from communities that we know that we need to have more engagement, we're not going to see that engagement. So we need to make sure there's more racialized organizers, there's more people from equity-seeking communities. We need to make sure that we have the people on the ground to do the work and to communicate with people. Well, we've done that so far, and we're going to continue to do that with your support.
I certainly appreciate my colleague's work, and certainly I know he raised a lot of money, and certainly a lot of that money was raised in Brampton. But my concern is how do we make sure that that's going to affect Lac Saint-Jean? How's that going to affect Moose Jaw? What we need to do is democratize our base. And this is the work that we've been doing, about talking with people, of making sure that we're building the grassroots teams across the country, because we need something that's solid that will be there in 2 and 3 and 4 years from now.
Well, when you fundraise, you can actually hire someone to work in Moose Jaw Bay. You can actually hire someone to work in different communities around Canada. So fundraising is a fundamental part of making sure that we have a campaign that can actually reach out to people in rural communities, in diverse communities, across Canada. We need to do that. That's a reality.
We're
I'm sure,
Charlie,
Nikki, you know
that. We're going to bring Nikki in now because we have about 30 seconds left.
Well, I would say what we most definitely need is a bold, progressive agenda. What's clear from movements to the south of us, like Bernie Sanders or Jeremy Corbyn in the UK, is that when you put forward bold ideas, when it comes to free tuition, tax reform, public ownership, when it comes to taking a stand for environmental justice and taking a stand against big oil, when you talk about the need for gender justice and racial justice, people mobilize, people get inspired. We've seen that through our campaign, longtime NDP members finally coming back to the party.
We will now move to our second candidate-to-candidate question period. To recap, the questioner will get 30 seconds to ask the question, followed by a 30-second response. Then there will be 30-second follow-up from the questioner, followed by another 30-second final response. The first candidate to pose a question to to one of her colleagues is Ms. Ashton.
Charlie, I'm proud of the vision that our campaign has put forward on economic justice as well as environmental justice. We must respect Indigenous rights, the environment, and look to protect and create good jobs. That's why I've come forward with a clear position against pipelines like Kinder Morgan and for a job creation strategy that is tied to federal investments in a green transition. What is your position on Kinder Morgan?
Well, Nikki, I thank you for that question because I came into politics fighting one of the largest environmental mega projects in Canadian history. And the night that the Kinder Morgan decision came down, I spoke with Premier Notley and expressed my concerns because we have 98,000 jobs directly associated to the eco-fragile ecosystem on the BC coast. So there are serious issues here. But the other issue also is being able to work as national leader with our colleagues in Alberta on economic diversification. That's what I'm committed to.
Okay, and back to Nikki.
Well, what I would say is that we need to understand that the status quo is the problem. When we're talking about Indigenous rights and the fate of the planet, there is no fence to sit on this. We must stand up with Indigenous communities, including those in BC. And yes, we can create good, sustainable jobs if we put forward a solid plan when it comes to the green transition, including the idea of a crown corporation that I've put forward. Wouldn't you agree that we can no longer afford the status quo?
Well, I think when we look at the devastation down in the Caribbean, ecological crisis is here. And there's no kicking this down the road any further. I think what really frustrated me in the House when I was first elected was to see the Liberals talking about voluntary emission standards. I come from mining country. The only reason they ever cleaned up the lakes and the only reason they ever cleaned up the atmosphere in mining country was from legislation. That's why we need to insist on hard caps right now to establish a carbon budget council to make sure that we get there, because we can't kick this off down the road. I thank you for your question.
Thank you. And Mr. Angus, 30 seconds.
Mr. Caron, I've got enormous respect for what you've done in this campaign, and this fall we will be going back into Parliament, and we have an amazing caucus, but we have to find a way to start building this team to start to win towards 2019. I liked your plan for building in Quebec. You said you were going to put 10 organizers on the ground. I love that. I don't think we ever had 10 organizers across the country, so we'll figure out the finances later because you're an economist. Yes. But what's your plan for making sure that we get that team moving as soon as we get back?
Well, I did release a plan called Quebec 2019 that's aimed at really giving ourselves what Jack was calling the winning strategy for Quebec. And the fact is that we need organizers. We failed to organize, as I said, to do the proper outreach when we had the opportunity and the resources, and we'll need to prioritize for the future. We also need to take into account the fact that we were able to be successful through the Sherbrooke Declaration. That was very useful to us, but we need to be able to modernize the Sherbrooke Declaration to take into account the realities of modern Quebec.
Well, I thank you for that. I was with Jack when that Sherbrooke Declaration was being crafted, and it did open so much for us in Quebec. My concern is that we have a caucus that has been underutilized. We have an approach that hired all our organizers in Ottawa and told them to represent Saskatchewan and Quebec and everywhere else. I want to know how you see that we connect the work of our caucus, our incredible leaders in the House, with the grassroots and putting organizers out in the field where they belong. Yeah.
Actually, we're not seeking agreement, but I will agree with you.
I will
agree with the fact that we have a very talented caucus, and their talent is actually are underutilized. And we need to ensure that I've been known in the past in the various organizations I work with that I was a person of consensus. I'm trying to get the consensus around me and to ensure that I will get the advice of the people who have the experience, who have the expertise, who have the knowledge, and ensure that we can maximize what they bring to the caucus, including outreach.
And Mr. Caron?
Charlie, I strongly believe that to form government in 2019 and beyond, we need strength in Quebec. And my plan includes hiring 10 full-time organizers, as you mentioned. And it's important to target 60 ridings because in 2015, we had 32 second place finishes, including 10 of them with a margin of less than 10%. I really do believe that a big comeback in Quebec is possible. Do you think there is a path to government for the NDP that does not include at least 40 MPs in Quebec?
C'est une bonne question, mon ami, parce que l'avenir de notre parti, pour moi, c'est au Québec. C'est essentiel. Le problème maintenant est les bases des militants, les plus grandes au Québec, mais le potentiel est énorme. Comme leader, ma priorité sera de réénergiser les bases partout au Québec, pour de travailler avec les équipes et les membres aussi, de donner un message clair que les équipes au Québec vont participer avec les équipes.
The reason why I do think it's important is when we compete in Quebec, we are lifted up across the country. That's clear. Winning in Quebec helps us to win seats across the country, including right here in British Columbia. I've asked you repeatedly over the course of the campaign what your plan for Quebec is. And I like the sentiment, but I don't see anything concrete. So this is the last kick at the can. What is your plan to be able to grow our caucus in Quebec?
La question pour moi est, j'étais avec Jack Layton quand il a fait la promesse pour développer les partis au Québec. Et pour cela, il a développé les bonnes relations avec les militants et progressistes. Et on a gagné beaucoup de succès en 2011. Mais quand je parle avec les députés et aussi les équipes au Québec maintenant, après l'élection de 2015, où était le plan?
And Mr. Singh.
Thank you. We're talking about Quebec. Let's continue talking about Quebec. The question is to Guy. This leadership race is an opportunity to organize for 2019 so that we can grow our party. And I believe in the unique importance of Quebec. That's why my team worked hard to sign up 1,500 new members in Quebec, close to a third of the membership. What is your approach to actually organizing and getting members signed up so we can build our party in this leadership race in Quebec?
Well, we have to acknowledge the great work that you have done in signing up members, but we still have a traditional weakness in the NDP, and we need to, in Quebec, and we need to acknowledge the reason for that as well. We don't have a current provincial party in Quebec, which doesn't help. I mean, we've seen the number rise in British Columbia because of the provincial election and the election of a new democratic government. That's great, but we have that challenge in Quebec. We need to ensure also that we are not going to be only in Montreal. We need to ensure that we'll be in every part of Quebec, and that will require organizing.
We also have a huge opportunity to gain Liberal-held ridings throughout urban and suburban areas in Canada. In Metro Vancouver, where my team has signed up 8,000 members to our party. There are 8 ridings that can be ours in 2019 if we organize effectively on the ground. What's your plan to win these seats so we can form government in the next election?
Once again, we have to roll up our sleeves and do the work that we haven't done in the 4 years and a half we were the official opposition. It's true that we are 10, 15 years behind in organizing from what liberals and conservatives have been doing. And this is why we're in third place right now. I'm talking about having organizers in Quebec. We have to have organizers all across the country and in places such as Vancouver and British Columbia, but also where we are absent right now, like Toronto and like Atlantic Canada. And we cannot be a true national party without representation.
Thank you, everyone. We're now going to be moving to another 60-second question. And the first candidate to respond will be Mr. Singh. The question, over the next 2 years, the NDP needs to pay off its debt and raise more than $30 million to be competitive in the 2019 election, as we were just discussing. As leader, how would you meet this fundraising challenge?
First of all, fundraising is not a four-letter word. Fundraising is not a bad thing. We need to fundraise. It's a reality. I am confident in our team's ability to fundraise. It takes a team to do this. I want to make sure it's clear that it wasn't me by myself, but I gave it importance. As a team, we made sure that funding was a key, and we made sure it was linked to reaching out to new communities, people that we had not spoken with before, and about 75% of our donations were from people that were first-time donors to the party. We know that there's many people out there that want to support and want to donate. We can build the infrastructure to do so. We've developed phone banks that are targeting and reaching out to certain communities, certain issue-based communities, to make sure that we reach out to those who see an alignment with our values and our policies. We're making sure that we use social media to reach and engage people. And we're on the ground holding fundraisers regularly. Every community we go to, we hold fundraisers to make sure that we connect with people and we also raise the funds so we can be competitive. This is an important issue. We know that fundraising helps us hire organizers, which means we can win.
Mr. Angus.
I think one of the really important things, again, is we have to give people a reason to believe in us and a reason to trust us. And as New Democrats, it ain't slogans, my friends. It ain't going to be selfies. Liberals can run a national machine on a celebrity. We have to be there in the House, doing the hard work so that people have a reason to believe us. And we have to tie our outreach strategies to the issues, not of the issue of the day that CBC decides is the issue of the day, but the issue of the week and the issue of the time of the people that we represent. And as part of that, we have an enormous opportunity with our caucus, incredible MPs, to start getting them out in the field, to start to build a democratic movement. This was how we used to do things, and we stopped doing things. So all we have now are the endless pings asking for money. We have to tie our work in Parliament to an agenda that stands up for people, that goes back to the people to ask for their support, and then we put the organizers in the field to start signing them up so that they're with us in the long term.
Ms. Ashton.
Well, without question, what we need to put forward is a bold, progressive platform for change. And what we've seen through our campaign is when you put forward that vision, people respond. And they respond by joining the party, coming back to the party, and also donating to the party. I can tell you that we've certainly appreciated some of the bigger donations, but I'm proud that we are a campaign of small donations that have been building over time, incredible support. I've heard from students that have been able to give just a little bit, but because they believe in free tuition, from seniors that are struggling, that have given money because they believe in tackling the inequality, intergenerational inequality that people are facing. We have to be strong on the issues with substance, with a plan, and we need to work with social movements and activists beyond the 44 parts of the country that we get elected in and expand across the country, recognizing that there are so many that share our values and that would be willing to support the kind of ideas we're putting forward if we listen and work together in solidarity.
Mr. Caron.
It pains me. It really pains me to tell you, but we need to take our cue from the Conservatives. It's the way that they're doing it, and I agree that we need to fundraise on the ground, and we need to take every single opportunity when we're outreaching to fundraise. But Conservatives were able to strategize in the House and to build a strategy as a communications tool and a fundraising tool as well. Gun registry was something that's important to their base, and they were bringing it every single occasion in the House. And they were fundraising, and they were communicating their efforts through that fundraising effort. So we can't see and we can't look at fundraising as being an independent component of what we're doing. We need to integrate the issues, the need for fundraising with the work we're doing in the House. too often we're doing great work in the House, which is not used for to be communicated to the members, to be able to energize our base and to fundraise. We need to start doing it and doing it efficiently.
Thank you, candidates. Our seventh 60-second question of the afternoon is, over the course of the campaign, you have all talked about the importance of the ground game and organizing for success in 2019. Where would your plan focus and how would it ensure the NDP party sees success in key regions of the country? Mr. Angus, you have 60 seconds.
Well, Jack Layton called me to be part of a movement when we had 13 seats and we started to build very carefully and we built it from the ground up. And that was the beginning of the orange wave. And I think that we have to look at going back to our roots. Certainly, we are not going to give up the ground that we won in 2011 in Quebec. That, to me, will be the prime objective of the leader, is to be back in Quebec because we have such enormous opportunity. But it's also the strategy that we brought forward in this whole campaign, which was to build the teams, autonomous teams across the regions, asking people to sign up 10 members themselves so that we go back to that old school. You know, everything's new, everything's old is new again. And we have to think in terms, not just of digital, which is great, not just of social media, which is really important, but building that relationship, that kitchen table trust, because that's what social democracy is rooted in. That's where I will be focused on.
Ms. Ashton, 60 seconds.
Well, as leader, what I would make very clear, as we've done in this campaign, is the need to build our movement. Yes, we are a political party, but our history is to be much more than that, to be a movement for system change, for fundamental change. And this time is more important than ever, really, when we look at the immense challenges we're facing, growing inequality and the threat of climate change. A strong New Democrat voice and an approach to organizing that's movement-based is so critical. I would say as leader, I'm well placed to engage with millennials, my generation, that are facing the greatest kind of intergenerational inequality we've ever seen. A generation that will pay the deep cost of climate change if we don't get this right. I'm also very clear in the need to engage with women across this country. Justin Trudeau and the Liberals have tried to work with women, but the reality is they're breaking promises to us. We need to make sure that we're working with diverse communities, immigrant communities, racialized communities, communities across this country with bold ideas.
Thank you. Mr. Caron?
Many pundits, many commenters, observers actually said that the last parliament, we were one of the most efficient official oppositions seen in decades. And we still ended up in third place. The work that we do in the House is important. But what we're seeing in modern politics now is the need to go and build bridges with the communities, with our base, to connect with Canadians in that fashion. This is why I proposed that we should put the focus, not only for myself as the leader, but also to use our talented caucus to go and build those bridges and to meet those members in their homes, in their kitchens, and ask those members to invite their community or their neighborhoods. They can be Liberals, Conservatives, Greens, NDPers, non-voters. We need to hear from them. We need to do that work, and it's worked in the past. I give the experience of Faut qu'on se parle in Quebec, but the Manitoba government did it back in the 80s when they were in difficulty, and it was successful. So we need to go back to our roots and reconnect in that fashion.
Mr. Singh.
Thank you very much. We are at a crucial moment. Canadians need us to be in a better position so we can fight for the issues that matter. So we need to be strategic about it. There's racialized communities, diverse communities we need to reach out to. We absolutely need to do that. But we're locked out of certain regions entirely. We have no seats in Atlantic Canada right now. I spent some time in Nova Scotia, and we know that there's a base in South Shore and Halifax. Prairie provinces are a place that's very strong for us. We need to build there. Toronto is a massive area, vote-rich area, a place where I'm very well known. I have a lot of supports there. We built really strong connections on the ground. Suburban communities make up 35% of seats in Canada. So not only do we need to work in urban communities and in rural communities, but suburban communities are specific. I won the first time ever in the history of the region of both Brampton and Mississauga any seat for the New Democrats. We did that as a team, but we know how to outreach. And Vancouver, BC, this is a key area for us. We're going to win back seats in Vancouver. With your help, we'll make it happen.
Well, everyone, it's time now for our final question. It will be another 60-second response from each candidate. The question is, building on the discussion here. If you were elected leader, what result would constitute a victory in the 2019 election? And what is the specific electoral path that gets the party there? Ms. Ashton, you're up first.
Well, first of all, I will say that our goal needs to be to form government, absolutely going forward, because that is the way we can affect change politically through Parliament. But I will say that that this path to government may take more than a couple of years, and that's because I believe that there needs to be some strong grassroots work that gets done. We need to support our 44 MPs that are there, and many of which are new MPs. But we also need to look at which parts of the country we can win in. We need to look at how we can build the party across the country, and this does require a lot of hard work. As leader, I'd be prepared to do that kind of work and recognize that there are key constituencies that we need to be working with. I want to go back to the work we need to be doing with young people in our country. The largest voting bloc in the next election will be the millennial generation. We need to make sure that we're connecting with that generation. We need to make sure that we're building a movement based on the issues that matter to them and to all of us when it comes to justice.
Thank you. We're at time. Mr. Caron.
Jack Layton's legacy to this party was to make us understand that we can not only be the conscience of Parliament. It's important to be the conscience of Parliament because it helps us to identify social and economic problems to be addressed, to denounce them in the House. But instead of just asking Liberals or Conservatives to do something about it, we need to demonstrate that we will propose those solutions and will seek government to implement them. That was Jack's legacy, and this is why we need to always look to form government, and 2019 will not be the exception. Now, we have been excluded from some areas. We're talking about Atlantic Canada, from Toronto. We need to ensure that we have a strategy that will make us, again, a party that represents all parts of the country. And we need to make sure that we will do so by connecting, once again, individually, but also connecting by ensuring that the issues of all the regions, including British Columbia, will be complemented in a regional platform that will be presented. And those platforms need to be inspiring.
Mr. Angus.
I remember after the loss in 2015 and not wanting to go out, not wanting to talk to people, because I was just so disheartened that we blew it. And one night I was at, I've told this story before, Nikki's Sports Bar in Timmins, and Kim, the bartender, came up to me and she said, "What the heck happened to you guys? You were supposed to be there for us, and we did not hear your voice." The reason, my friends, that we're involved in this is we have to be that voice, and we have to give people a reason to believe that we're not just talking to the Ottawa bubble and we're not just talking to ourselves, but we're bringing forward a credible, practical change that is needed now more than ever with the growing economic insecurity, with people unable to live in the house, communities that they built, unable to get past student debt. We have to be in this House this fall, holding this government to a court account, because we don't get to ask for a promotion in 2019. If we're not doing the hard work now in 2017 for the working class of this country.
Mr. Singh.
Our goal must be forming government in 2019. That's our goal. But the broad idea of what we want to do is we want to be in a position of power to implement our principles, to implement our values, to build a more progressive and just Canada. So to do that, we need, what is success? Success would be for me that if we put our position, our party into a position of power to implement change for a better Canada, a more just and equitable Canada. So how do we do that? There's a traditional avenue. We've talked about it, having fundraising and organizers on the ground, signing up new members and building our party. We also need to inspire people. And this is a bit of the more intangible element, inspiring people and using alternative forms to inspire people. We know that we don't often get the best media coverage. If we get it, that's amazing. But we also need to be able to compete with people in other forms of media, social media, to have the way to inspire people, to get our message out there so we can use a platform that inspires folks even if the traditional media doesn't support us. We need to be in that position. So there's a dual path with the strategic path that involves members and also this intangible path.
Okay, well, folks and candidates, that is all the questions for today's debate. We will now move to closing statements. Each candidate will get 90 seconds, and we're going to start with Ms. Ashton.
The final debate. Soon the choice will be yours. I offer a clear vision. A bold, progressive agenda. Je vous propose une vision claire, une plateforme audacieuse et progressiste. The politics of the future today. The time for incremental change is over. With growing inequality and catastrophic climate change, we must be bold again. It starts with reminding ourselves of what it's really all about, that we as New Democrats reject the 150 years of liberal and Tory status quo. We are not involved in politics for politics' sake. At heart, we are all idealists. Tommy Douglas once said, we should never, never be afraid or ashamed about dreams. Fellow New Democrats, it is time to dream again of building a better Canada and a better world. It starts with electing the first federal NDP government in history in 2019. We can do it together. We can and we will build a movement for social, environmental, and economic justice for all. Thank you. Merci.
Thank you. Mr. Caron?
I'll be honest, when I launched my campaign back in February, who's that guy was a comment I heard frequently. But I kept my head down and a campaign hard over 100 events in rural and urban communities. And my message is clear. In the last 30 years, liberals and conservatives have followed the same recipe. They tell us that we should just get used to it, that precarious work and that living paycheck to paycheck is the new natural way of life. There's nothing natural about the fact that our kids, the next generation of Canadians, will be worse off than the previous generation. It comes from short-sighted political choices influenced by big money to the detriment of the many. Un changement fondamental ne sera pas facile. Nous devons convaincre les progressistes de revenir vers nous. Politics, as usual, won't cut it. And that's why I offered a detailed, ambitious, and truly progressive agenda for change, a blueprint for achieving electoral success across the country. I'm not shy about saying that I want to win in 2019 or that I believe the NDP can't win power without a strong showing in Quebec. Jack Layton knew this. Winning in Quebec helps us win seats across the country. And that's a central question in this race. These days, I don't hear, who's that guy, so much. Instead, more and more people are saying, I like that Guy. Truly, I'm truly, truly humbled and inspired by your support. I am ready to lead. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Angus.
Je vous remercie pour votre participation à cet événement. Et d'abord, je voudrais dire que je suis très fier d'avoir l'opportunité de participer à la course avec mes amis ici. You know, when I first met Jack Layton, I didn't own a suit. I was doing speeches on the back of a pickup truck for Indigenous and farmers who were blockading the largest garbage dump in Canadian history. And Jack called me and said, hey, I got this idea. I want to be the leader of a party with 13 seats, and I want you to join me. Leaders create leaders, and that's the work that I've done. And I joined with Jack for another reason, because he had a vision that it wasn't simply about being a party of protest, that we would organize to form government to make real change. And I'm here, my friends, to complete that vision, because we had an enormous opportunity in 2015, and we blew it. We blew it because we were too safe, and we assumed that it was our time. It will be our time when we make it our time. And that means being rooted in the grassroots and never forgetting why we're here, which is to speak up for people who are being written off the political and economic map of our nation. What we do in Parliament as a New Democratic Caucus matters, because we have to show people that we are ready this fall to fight for them so that they will trust us to fight for them as government in 2019. I'm asking for your support. Thank you, my friends.
And Mr. Singh.
New Democrats must form government so we can build a better country. On doit être au pouvoir pour mettre en place un programme progressiste. That's what this leadership race is about. Who will get us ready for 2019? My team has already started. We recruited 47,000 new members, thousands in liberal ridings held right now, and laying the groundwork to take on Trudeau. We signed up over 10,000 members here in BC. 2,000 in Surrey Newton, 1,000 members in Surrey Centre. These are two of the many ridings we're going to take from Trudeau in 2019. In the Toronto area, 50 of 59 seats are currently held by Liberals. That's where our team recruited 25,000 new Democrats, making our path to victory clear. And while we have much work to do in Quebec, our team recruited almost a third of the entire NDP membership in the province. We're building a coalition, including labor endorsements from the UFCW and the machinists. Imaginez ce qu'on peut faire de plus ensemble. Think about what we've done in just 2 months. Now imagine what we can build together in 2 years. I'm asking for your support because together we will form Canada's first NDP government in 2019. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes today's debate, the final debate of the 2017 NDP leadership race. Now, audience, let it out. We know you want to make some noise. A round of applause for our candidates.